I'd like to welcome today's panelists, Professor Bola Akintenriwa, Director General, Bulitak Center for International Diplomacy and Strategic Studies, and Ayo Teriba, CEO, Economic Associates. Gentlemen, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Malians take to the polls today, Sunday, to decide on their next president. These elections are considered crucial for the West African nation's return to constitutional rule and stability. To decide whether or not to give President Ibrahim Boubacar Keïta a second term. There are 24 candidates, one of whom is a woman. Since coming into power 5 years ago, the president's administration has been fraught with widespread ethnic and jihadist violence. And in Zimbabwe, final campaign rallies are rounding off, as Zimbabweans prepare to go to the polls on Monday in the first vote since former Robert Mugabe was ousted in November after his 37-year rule. 23 presidential candidates and 128 political parties will participate in the election. Robert Mugabe has come out to say he will vote for the opposition party. Let's take a look at the situation.
I cannot vote for those who have commented. I can't.
Prof, you are the international affairs expert. I mean, democracy seems to be on a roll in Africa. We've been having a series of elections. This year alone, we've had quite a lot of elections across Africa. But we have a special situation in Zimbabwe. But let's start with Mali. What do you think is going to play out in Mali?
Well, I think that it's going to be a little bit difficult to foresee. Why? You will recall that in June 2018, there were public protests against even the nomination of Keïta as an incumbent. All right. Many people were against. They do not even want him at all to contest. And you know quite well that on the basis of law, he's quite eligible to contest. The Malian system of election is the French model. Two rounds, all right, in order to have absolute majority, and it's for a 5-year term. But the people are complaining, they do not want him to exercise his right anyway. Okay, people ought to wait until he's defeated before you can say he cannot contest. So when you look at the grounds of the general public on the one hand, and then you now look at his legitimate right to contest on the other, you cannot begin to look at the
pattern. Don't you think this is propaganda from the former Prime Minister Modibo Sidibe gaining an upper hand?
You cannot be more correct. It can be propaganda, but the issue is that at the end of the day, when you see people coming out forcefully, you know, Mali is a special case even for study. You know quite well that these Tuaregs, you know, constitute a major problem there.
And himself has had to make the point to say, look, the major challenge for his administration has been the challenge of, should I use the word Boko Haram, you know, but it's a terrorism and insurgency and all of that.
Yeah, that's why I agree with you, because he's challenged, first of all, by regional insecurity. Mm. Mali is within, you know, the region of insecurity since the demise of Muammar Gaddafi in Libya and the returnees to Mali. So he has been faced with this type of insecurity. But it does not appear to the electorate that they want to recognize this challenge of insecurity.
But correct me if I'm wrong. I think you were DG of Director General of the Nigerian Institute of International Affairs at the time when Mali treated Nigeria badly, because we did a lot of Mali during that their transition period and the crisis that they had. But they gave the credit to France, and Nigeria was very unhappy about that.
But you see, I have to salute your sagacious mind because you are able to recollect vividly what actually happened. Nigeria led, for instance, the regional organizational committee set up. But at the end of the day, credit was not given to Nigeria. And in this particular case, this has always been borne in mind in Nigeria's foreign policy calculations. So I think that at the end of the day, specifically to look at the question you raised, how will it go? Well, Sisi, as an opposition leader, has a large following. But the incumbent also not only has that large following, but the power of incumbency. The issue is that here in Africa, we have a mania of getting popular support without really having the support. You know, every...
Popular support without legitimacy.
Yes, precisely. So at the end of the day, it all depends on the position of some influential countries like France. Which candidate is France in support of? We cannot rule that one out. Secondly, when you look at Mali is a very good member in terms of active participation in ECOWAS activities.
Yeah, but they don't always pay their bills.
No, there are many countries. They do not always pay their assess dues. They are there. Look at Mauritania. Mauritania was a member, a founding member of the ECOWAS. It opted out. It went to the Maghreb. But when it got to Maghreb now, it reached a block. They couldn't go further. Mauritania is looking, all right, desperately to come back. Even Morocco, which was never a member of ECOWAS, is itching to come back to the ECOWAS. So you see, at the end of the day...
No, but the ECOWAS membership is within the context of African integration.
No, you are right. But Morocco is in the northern region, not in the West African region.
Yeah, but you know, Morocco has issues with Algeria, with Tunisia, you know. And the present king, Mohammed VI, right, has a vision of integration with the rest of Africa.
No.
That's not the subject
we need to put integration in context, not the Moroccan type of
That's not the subject before us. But what do we expect in the Malian election?
Well, under normal circumstances, we expect that it should be peaceful. It should be fair. You know, the conduct and management of elections in Africa, what we really need is to see visibly, transparently, all right, an election in which people vote and the vote counts. All right. So Mali is a little bit different. You know, the Francophone countries are not generally used to the Anglophone style of election. All right. They are not as violent as we do in this part of the world.
Well, except in Côte d'Ivoire, in recent memory.
Well, Côte d'Ivoire was a little bit different, too. You know, when you have the big powers, France had a critical role in the election in the Côte d'Ivoire. You have French citizens living, all right? There are many Ivoirians had a dual nationality, all right? When it comes now to electoral allegiance, it becomes difficult. You have the vested interests of the United Nations in the Côte d'Ivoire. You have South Africa also coming in. And now Nigeria now had to come in at a particular time, all right, to ensure that, look, ECOWAS' decision was complied with.
Anyway, we are hoping that the Malians will have a good day today. International observers are all over the place, hundreds and thousands of them, trying to make sure that all goes well. And the processes leading to the election today have been relatively very peaceful and, you know, reassuring. And we hope that whatever happens at the day, either President Keita gets a second term or somebody else replaces him, that it will be a good day for democracy.
The president we need in Mali Africa is one who will be pro-Africa in all his strategic calculations.
Yeah, well, I mean, this has been a challenge in all the Francophone countries. But the situation in Mali will seem to be slightly different from what is going on in Zimbabwe. So I come to you, Teriba. In Zimbabwe, former president is saying he will not vote for his own party. He doesn't even want to vote for Mnangagwa. His choice candidate is Chamisa. You know, they seem to have a very delicate political situation in Zimbabwe. What do you think?
Yeah, you have about 23 candidates lined up, of which only two are considered, you know, having any good chance, you know, of getting a result, which includes the incumbent. Well, because of the way Mugabe was edged out of power, he has every reason to begrudge his party, because they were the ones after that military intervention that
But do you think his protest from the wheelchair will make any difference?
I doubt that it will make any difference, because if he had the clout, he was trying to install his wife against the current president, you know. So if he did have the majority support, the party might not have been able to hedge him out as easily as they did. You know, so let's just hope, you know.
No, it's quite arguable. The question is quite pertinent. If you look at the followership of Robert Mugabe in himself.
Yes.
And if Robert Mugabe decides to call on his people.
Yes.
Not to vote.
Yes.
For Mnangagwa. That can seriously impact
his followership. His followership is concentrated within the party that he now chooses to oppose. His followership is concentrated within the party that edged him out.
It's not the, it's not the party that actually edged him out. You should remember, there was this incumbent president who had the support of the military.
Yes.
All right. It was more of a military coup.
Under
pressure from the party, that if he didn't, you know. Anyway,
In Africa, we are faced with two major elections.
Yes.
Today, tomorrow.
Yes.
You know, and how that plays out is going to be very interesting for the democratization consolidation process in Africa.
If I could.
And for our mapping of the democratic process as intellectuals. Yeah.
The Malian situation, the Malian pre-election dynamics seems to have a lot of parallels with Nigeria, in which the incumbent and the front runner is being called upon, rather than being met at the polls, is being called upon by groups not to contest, you know. And it's interesting that Prof has drawn, you know, the two issues there. There is the legitimacy. Okay, and there is the, you know, legal situation. Yes,
the key issue will be stability, security, productivity, good governance.
Prosperity, yeah.
After the election,
that's right.
You know, because Mali has been in a very delicate situation for some time, and Zimbabwe faces more or less the same challenge.
Yes. Well, the rules. I mean, somebody was saying that there are two rules of success, and that goes for the incumbents. It's the first rule is don't quit, even when people call upon you to quit. And it says the second rule is remember the first rule. You know, so you are called upon not to contest.
Well, in any case, we keep a vigilant eye on developments in both Mali and Zimbabwe. Two major elections taking place in Africa, as we keep a watch also on the democratic process in Africa. We'll take a short break on this Daylight, the Sunday Talk Show. We'll be back shortly.